Thank you for being here. I want you to know that this program tonight is brought to you by the Lionsville College Chaplain's Office, the Office of Student Services, and the Christian Education and Leadership Program. And on behalf of all those, I welcome you. For the past 39 years, Holocaust survivors has shared her remarkable story.
I have never had to cover my head before.
It's good. She's been sharing her stories with students and teachers, medical professionals, government and business leaders, college and community groups, both nationally and internationally. Eva is one of the few surviving twins sharing her personal account of the medical experience supervised by the notorious Nazi doctor Joseph Mengele at Auschwitz. Eva's account of her survival of the Holocaust offers many relevant lessons on the dangers of hate and prejudice, and the consequences of allowing prejudice to persist unchecked in other people. In addition to the importance of her account from a historical perspective, Eva's life lessons and message of forgiveness have touched the lives of thousands of people. In 1995, Eva chose to forgive the Nazis after deciding that they should no longer have power over her. She describes forgiving the Nazis as an act of self-healing, self-liberation, and self-empowerment. Forgiveness, she says, is not about the perpetrator. It's not about forgetting. It is just one step toward repairing the world by helping victims free themselves from perpetrators and thereby remove anger and hatred. Eva shares her own discovery of the power to forgive so that others may see the possibility to heal themselves through forgiveness. Forgiveness provides a way for people to free themselves from hurt, anger, and pain. If people find peace within themselves, she says, the world itself may also find peace. She's the recipient of the 2017 Sachem Award, the highest...
Sachem
Award, thank you. The highest honor in the state of Indiana. Eva's message of healing reaches around the globe and across social, economic, and cultural boundaries. Will you join me in welcoming Eva Kaur to Limestone tonight?
Thank you very much, you brave soul. We are going to share this room with Beth. I have never done that before, and I hope that we win, not the Beth. Thank you, Ron, very much for the introduction and for inviting me. I will just begin my lecture as I usually do. My name is Eva Kaur. I am a survivor of Auschwitz, a survivor of medical experiments conducted by Dr. Mengele. And now that I am 84 years old, I am primed to survive old age. And I found out that there are a lot more challenges as one gets older. My lecture is divided in three parts. Part one, how I survived Auschwitz. Part two, the lessons that I have learned from my unusual life, which is really very important. And part three, I will entertain maybe three questions, and then the rest of it, I am going to answer to you when you come up to buy a book, to get a picture or an autograph. I was born in 1934 in a tiny village in Transylvania, Romania. The village name is Sport. It had 100 families, all Christian, except my family, the Moses family, that was Jewish. In the Moses family, there were six people. My father, Alexander Moses, he was born in 1900, so he was 44 years old in 1944 when we were taken away. My mother, Jaffa, was 38. My oldest sister, Edith, was 14. My middle sister, Alice, was 12. And Miriam and I, twins, were 10 years old. Transylvania is a region in Romania right next door to the Hungarian border. War II started on September 1, 1939. By May of 1940, Transylvania was occupied by Hungary, by the Hungarian army, and everything changed. My father had to go every 2 weeks to the nearby police station. If he didn't, he was going to be arrested. School started in the fall. We had a one-room schoolhouse. There were about 40 to 44 kids between the ages of 6 and 10. They were teaching the basics, reading, writing, and arithmetic. The new book that was issued had the following math problem. If you have 5 Jews and you kill 3, how many are left? That is the way I studied arithmetic in the school. Everything in our life was surrounded with how to catch and kill Jews. Actually, every year, the Hungarians passed at least 2 new laws that made the life of Jewish people much more difficult. The year that I remember was 1942. I was 8 years old. The 2 new laws that were passed were that Jews could not hire anybody but Jewish people, which meant in our village we couldn't hire anybody. As it happened, my mother got sick in the summer of 1942, and my father asked the area commandant for a permission. That was the second law, that we couldn't travel anywhere without a special permit. My father's permit was rejected, request for a permit to travel. So here I am, 8 years old, and I could feel in every ounce of my being that we were in big danger. I said to my father, "Daddy, the time has come for us to escape to Romania." The Romanian border was just 2 hours from our house. And the rumor was that life for Jews in Romania was much better than in Hungary. And it happened to be true. The diplomat, all the Jews in Romania, and the majority of the Jews in Romania survived. The majority of the Jews in Hungary were murdered. My father looked at me and said, "You are just a little kid. You do not understand the important issues in our life." I have a theory that children from age 6 to 13 are a lot smarter than people give them credit. After 13, I don't know what happened. All the hormones kick in and everything goes haywire. My father kept saying, "We have a nice house, we have plenty of food, you children go to school." And then he rationalized, he said, "The Germans won't come to this tiny village to arrest 6 Jews." Well, Daddy, I am eternally sorry that you were 100% wrong and I, the 8-year-old kid, was 100% right. 1944, middle of March of 1944, about 74 years ago, at this time, 2 gendarmes came to our house with guns, gave us 2 hours to pack food and clothing, because they said they were taking us to the regional ghetto. What do you pack in 2 hours? And why did they have the right to come to our house and arrest us? We didn't do anything. But that is what happened. Throughout Europe, there were ghettos. These ghettos were actual prisons, not like the ghettos in the city today. And they have sprung up in many countries. Some were big ghettos, some were small ghettos. Ours was very small. We were a rural area. In our village was only one Jewish family. The next village might have had two. So it took quite a while to gather 8,500 Jews. Our ghetto was an open field surrounded by tall barbed wire fences and guarded by guards with guns. There were no buildings. We built our tents out of sheets and blankets. So we were taken away to the ghetto middle of March of 1944. We were there half of March, all of April, and half of May. It was springtime. It rained a lot. The ground was often wet. But we kept telling ourselves, as long as the family is together, somehow we are going to make it. My father, as the head of every other family, was taken in for interrogation. Interrogation means questioning by force. And if you don't answer the question, they beat you. So he was brought back on a stretcher with bleeding whip marks. All his fingernails and toenails were burned because they kept asking him, where did you hide all your gold? And my father kept telling them, I am a farmer. I put all my money in land. They didn't believe him. 3 days after my father was brought back, we were ordered to leave everything behind because they were going to take us to a labor camp in Hungary that will have everything we needed. We were herded into cattle cars, about 100 to a cattle car. There were only 4 little windows, 2 windows on each side for air. We were given not any supplies. Once the cattle car was packed, the door slid and the bar came across so we could not push the door open. There was no room to sit. We were just standing. And next to each cattle car there was a booth with a guard, with a machine gun, who clearly told us, anybody trying to escape, he said, I am going to shoot. The train moved very fast. It stopped only for one reason, to refuel. So when the train stopped, we asked the guard by our cattle car for water. Can you imagine how hot it was in the middle of May in a crowded cattle car? They would always say, 5 gold watches. So the grown-ups gathered the gold watches and passed through one of the windows. The guard took a bucket of water and threw it through one of the windows. I put my cup over my head, hoping to catch some water that was coming from one of the windows. I never got enough to drink, just a few drops. And at the time, I was wondering, why do we keep giving them gold watches and we are not even getting enough water? I did not dare ask anybody. And as I tried to remember, and I didn't deal with my story until 1978, I remember nobody was talking in our cattle car. I believe that people who are scared to death do not verbalize their thoughts. Everybody kind of turned inward. It was the 3rd day in the cattle car. Evening, it was dark outside, the train stopped. We asked for water, and the answer came back in German. I was 10 years old. I and everybody else in our cattle car understood what happened. We have crossed the border into Germany. Our Hungarian guards have been changed to German, and for all of us that meant that death was near. We were not taken to Hungary to a labor camp, but we were being taken to Germany to be murdered. People in the cattle car began to pray because that was the only thing left for them. And 8 hours later, they were still praying when the train stopped again. We again ask for water. This time there was no answer in any language. The cattle car doors opened. Thousands of people poured out of the cattle car onto a strip of land that measures 85 feet long by 35 feet wide, called the selection platform, because people were selected to live or to die. In my opinion, there is no other strip of land like that anywhere on the face of this earth. So as we stepped down, my mother grabbed my twin sister and me by the hand. We were her youngest children, and she hoped that as long as she could hold on to us, that somehow she could protect us. Everything was moving very fast. This was the most confusing place I have ever been to. Children were crying, Nazis were yelling orders, dogs were barking, and everybody was looking for their members of the family. I actually turned around on the selection platform and tried to figure out what on earth is this place. And as I turned around, I realized that my father and my two older sisters were gone. Never saw them again. As we were holding on to mother for dear life, a Nazi was running and yelling in German, "Twins, twins." We did not volunteer any information. He noticed Miriam and me. We looked alike, we were dressed alike, and he demanded to know if we were twins. And my mother asked, "Is that good?" And the Nazi said yes, and my mother said yes. That moment, another Nazi came, pulled my mother to the right, we were pulled to the left. We were crying, she was crying. I remember seeing her arms stretched out in despair as she was pulled away. I never even got to say goodbye to her, but I didn't understand that this would be the last time I would see her. All that took 30 minutes from the time we stepped down from the cattle car and my whole family was gone. Miriam and I were holding on to one another. And by the way, I want you to know that this was the last time I cried in Auschwitz. I want to tell you something. We live in a society that victimhood is nurtured. I don't think it helps the victims. And those victims who embrace the nurturing ought to take notice. If I would have cried in Auschwitz, I would not have had the set of state of mind to survive. Try it. You cannot cry when you have a problem and solve your problem. The two do not work together. So in order to survive, I always had the state of mind that I was going to do that. So what we became, as my mother was taken away, we were taken to a group of children. There were 13 sets of female twins between the ages of 2 and 16. And there was one mother, the mother's name was Mrs. Changery. She had twin daughters, younger than we were, and she was my mother's friend. Our group was taken from the selection platform to a processing center where our clothes immediately were removed and we sat naked for most of the day until late afternoon when our processing began. We were given short haircuts, our breasts were returned, with a huge oil-painted red cross on the back of the dress, which I learned years later that was because we were part of medical experiments. Then they lined us up for registration and tattooing. I watched 24 little girls being tattooed in front of me. I was number 25 and Miriam was number 26. I decided that I was going to give them as much trouble as a 10-year-old could. So when they grabbed my arm to tattoo it, I began to scream, "He can carry on." Four people restrained me, two Nazis and two women prisoners, while they heated a long needle attached to a wooden handle. They heated it over the flame of a lamp. When the needle got hot, they dipped it into ink, and then they burned into my left arm, dot by dot, the capital letter A-7063. Miriam became capital A-7064. Auschwitz was the only Nazi camp that tattooed its inmates. I compared notes with my sister years later, and she said that in addition to creating a general confusion, I beat the Nazi holding my arm. I am sure that I was capable of doing it, but I was raised to be a nice girl, so I don't remember it. I must have blocked it out of my mind. Once we were processed, we were marched throughout the camp. We arrived at a wooden modular horse barn, a barrack, filthy and crude. Inside the barrack was divided in two by a brick bench, then a walkway on each side of the bench, and then three-story high wooden bunk beds. Miriam and I were given a bunk bed on the bottom. It was covered with a thin straw mattress and a filthy blanket. And I thought it would be nice to be able to stretch out and maybe even sleep. I believe that human beings who survive a traumatic day like I did do not function normally, because I kept tossing and turning and I could not sleep. But as I was tossing and turning, I noticed something big and dark moving on the floor. I counted them. When I got to five, I jumped up screaming, "Mice, mice!" Coming from a farm, I was always scared of mice. A girl from the top bunk bed said, "Silly kid, these are not mice, these are rats. And you better get used to them because they are everywhere," and they were. So now we couldn't even try to go back to our own bunk beds because of the parading rats. We went to the latrine. As we entered the place, there on the filthy latrine floor, there were the scattered corpses of three children. I have never seen anybody dead before, but I realized that in this place, children were dying. So right then and there, I made a silent pledge that I would do anything and everything within my power to make sure that Miriam and I survive and walk out of this camp alive. From the moment we left the latrine, I did everything instinctively, and I did everything instinctively right. I never let any doubt or fear enter in my mind. Every morning, we would be awakened at 5 a.m. by the shrieking sound of a whistle. By 6 a.m., we were outside for roll call, summer, winter, rain, or blizzard. And by the time the winter of 1944-45 rolled around, my dress and shoes were filled with holes. We did not get winter clothes. How I survived, I have no idea. Because when I go back now to the camp for the anniversaries, I am dressed with UGG boots, wool coat, and I'm still freezing to death. After roll call, we would go back to the barrack for Dr. Mengele's daily inspection. He counted us every morning, except on Sunday. That is the way we knew it was Sunday. Then we would get breakfast. Breakfast at Auschwitz was a brownish, lukewarm, bitter, liquid, cold coffee, zero calories. Then we would be taken for experiments. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, we would be placed naked in a room up to 8 hours a day. They would measure every part of my body, compare it to my twin sister, and compare it to Chad's. These experiments were not dangerous, but they were unbelievably demeaning, and even in Auschwitz, I couldn't cope with the way they made me feel. After the third or fourth visit to that, I call it the observation lab, I learned to block it out of my mind. And everything that I tell you about Auschwitz, I learned from two sources, personal experience or rumors. Nobody, for the duration of the time we were in Auschwitz, which was between 8.5 and 9 months, ever explained to us what will happen to us and when it will happen. So, on Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday, we would be taken to another lab that I call the blood lab. They would tie both of my arms to restrict the blood flow, take a lot of blood from my left arm, and give me a minimum of 5 injections into my right arm. The content of those injections, we didn't know then, nor do I know today, 74 years later. The rumor was that they were germs, diseases, and drugs, and that is probably correct. After one of those injections, I developed a very high fever. I was trembling as the August sun was burning my skin. Both my arms and legs were swollen and very painful, and I was covered with red dots. Next visit to the blood lab, instead of tying my arms, they measured my fever, and I knew I was in trouble. I was immediately taken to the hospital. The hospital was another barrack, but it was filled with people who looked to me more dead than alive. Next morning, Dr. Mengele came in with 4 other doctors. He never ever examined me. He looked at my fever chart, and then he declared, laughing sarcastically. He said, "Too bad, she's so young, she has only 2 weeks to live." I knew he was right, but I refused to die. So I made a second silent pledge that I will prove Mengele wrong, I will survive and be reunited with my twin sister Miriam. For the following 2 weeks, I have only one clear memory. I remember crawling on the barrack floor because I no longer could walk. And I was crawling on the barrack floor to reach a faucet with water at the other end of the barrack, because this barrack was not even allocated water. People were brought there to die. And as I was crawling, it took me a long time to get to that faucet. I would fade in and out of consciousness, and even in a semi-conscious state of mind, I kept telling myself, I must survive, I must survive. This is the most powerful experience that I have ever had in my life, at any time where I have difficulties. I always say to myself, if I could survive crawling on the barrack floor for 2 weeks, I can survive anything. In life, when you have a difficulty, do not give up. Try to overcome the difficulty and it will become a source for power for you, because you can do exactly as I did. You can always go back to that experience and tell yourself, if I survive this, I can survive anything. After 2 weeks, my fever broke and I felt immediately better. It took me another 3 weeks before my fever chart showed normal, and amazingly, I was released and reunited with the other twins and my twin sister Miriam. Dying in Auschwitz was very easy. Living was a full-time job. What did it take to survive in Auschwitz? In my opinion, two things. A lot of luck and an unbelievable will to live. If you didn't have both of these things, you would die. Miriam was sitting on her bed, staring into space. That was very dangerous. That meant to me that Miriam has given up her will to live. Why it happened, I didn't know then. I asked her, what on earth happened to you while I was in the hospital? She said, I cannot talk about it, I will not talk about it. And Miriam and I never talked about Auschwitz until 1985. That's a very long time. I believe if children have to fight for their life, they cannot go back to the experience until they feel physically safe. And second, emotionally strong enough to cope with it. In 1985, I asked Miriam, said, do you remember when I was taken to the hospital? She said, yes. I said, okay, what happened to you while I was in the hospital? She said, for the first 2 weeks, after you were taken away, I was kept in isolation with Nazi doctors studying me day and night, and they were waiting for something to happen. They didn't tell me what that was, and nor do I know if it happened or it didn't happen. Well, it was the same 2 weeks that Dr. Mengele said that I would die. According to the Auschwitz Museum, would I have died, Miriam would have been killed with an injection to the heart, and the Mengele would have done the comparative autopsies. I told Miriam, I spoiled the experiment. I survived. And amazingly, nor Miriam nor I were killed. According to the Auschwitz Museum, Mengele used 1,500 sets of twins in his experiment, which means 3,000 individuals. The estimated survivors were between 180 and 200 individuals of Mengele's experiments survived Auschwitz. Most of them died in the experiments. In normal life, you cannot take a set of twins, inject one with disease, and when that one dies, you kill the other one to do the comparative autopsies. But in Auschwitz, everything was possible. So I asked Miriam, what happened to you after the 2 weeks were up? She said she was taken back to the lab, injected with many injections that made her feel very sick. We were liberated on January 27, 1945. We were in refugee camps with Mrs. Cengeli and her two daughters for about 9 months in three different refugee camps, and we arrived home in Romania October 1945 to find that no one survived. Our house was ransacked. All I could find were three crumbled pictures on a bedroom floor. And that was all that was left of my family. We were taken in by Aunt Irena, my father's younger sister who lived in a big city. She married a guy who lost all his family, and so we were the patched up family. But by 1946, March of 1946, the communists took over. They had wonderful slogans, freedom, brotherhood, equality. I have never heard such big words before. I liked them, so I joined the Youth Communist Party. Fast forward to 1948. I was 14 years old in 48, and I was the president of the Communist Party at my school, and I had under my supervision 30 pioneers with red neckties. May is a very May Day. May 1st is an important holiday, so I took my troop to May Day parade. At noon, we had a picnic in the park, and then they wanted me to take the troop for a torch parade. Well, I am a survivor of Auschwitz. I wasn't afraid, but I thought we were parading too much, and I needed to study for the test next day, so I sent everybody home. Next day, I was called into headquarters. Where were you yesterday with your troop? And I simply told him I thought we were parading too much and I needed to study for my test. He began pounding the table. When you are in the Communist Party, you are not supposed to sing. You are supposed to follow orders. I said, if I cannot sing, I don't want to be in your party. He began laughing. He said, okay, we can kick you out, but there is no school in Romania that you can attend. At age 14, I thought that I still needed to learn a few things. I remained with the Communist Party, but I can tell you I was never again a good communist. My aunt Irena said, I don't know how, Eva, you are always in trouble. There is no future for you here in Romania. Luckily, Israel became a state, and we applied for a visa to immigrate to Israel. Romania didn't want us to leave. They wouldn't get us our exit visa. It took us 2.5 years to get our visa, and then they wouldn't let us take anything except the clothes on our back. So in June of 1950, I bought 3 dresses and a winter coat. And that is the way we arrived in Israel. Miriam and I were sent to an agricultural school where we worked 4 hours in the fields. It's the best thing for traumatized children. I wish if I had the powers, I would close every juvenile center and open agricultural schools. Children who are traumatized, they don't need to be punished. They need to be involved in something positive. Taking care of plants and animals, it's a very interesting therapeutic effect. After 2 years, we were 18 years old. We were drafted into the Israeli army. Miriam was sent to medical corps. She studied and became a registered nurse. I was sent to engineering corps. I studied and became a draftsman. I was stationed in Tel Aviv. I liked it, so I remained in the Israeli army for 8 years, reaching the rank of sergeant major. In 1960, I met and married a tourist from Terre Haute, Indiana, who is also a survivor. He survived Buchenwald, and he was liberated by Lieutenant Colonel Andrew Neff from Terre Haute, Indiana. My husband spoke Russian and German, and he became the interpreter for Lieutenant Colonel Andrew Neff. And when the war ended, Lieutenant Colonel Andrew Neff said to my husband, I'm going home to America. My husband said to him, you American people are very nice. I would like to go to America. Will you help me? And he did. So my husband arrived in Terre Haute, Indiana in March of 1946. So when we got married in 1960, and he never wanted to live anywhere else, Terre Haute was the place he was going to live. So we got married in April of 1960, and I came from Tel Aviv to Terre Haute. The only thing in common these two cities have is the letter T. Miriam got married in 1958. She married an Israeli. In 1960, she expected her first child and she developed severe kidney infections. that did not respond to any antibiotic. Second pregnancy in 1963, her kidney infections were so severe that the Israeli doctors studied her, and they found out that Miriam's kidneys never grew larger than the size of a 10-year-old child. I begged Miriam. I said, you have two children, that's pretty good. Don't have any more children. Every pregnancy is a life crisis. But she didn't listen to me. She had a third child 12 years later in 1975. And after the child was born, her kidney started to deteriorate and the doctors couldn't help her. By 1987, they failed, at which time she had two options, go on dialysis or have a kidney transplant. She opted, without even talking to me, she put her name on a kidney transplant list. I had two kidneys, one sister. I had a simple choice. I donated one of my kidneys and we were a perfect match. I donated November 16, 1987. A year after the transplant, Miriam developed cancerous polyps in her bladder. At that hospital, they already been doing kidney transplants for 10 years, and they had 2,000 survivors. All of them were given anti-rejection medication. None of them developed cancerous polyps. Miriam was the only Mengele twin. The Israeli doctors kept urging me to find our Auschwitz files. I have tried everything. I protested in the Capitol Rotunda in 1960, yes. And I protested because I wanted to find out what was in Mengele's files. And I was arrested, roughed up, brutally roughed up. They tore my right rotator cuff so I can't lift it any higher than what I can. I never found our files, never found out what was injected into our bodies. Miriam's cancer metastasized and she died June 6, 1993. I will take you back to the camp because I want you to understand how little 10-year-old children cope in a place like Auschwitz. All of you have traveled with young children. There are here some young children. And how many of you ever say, when do we get there? When do we get there? You have to understand that little children don't want to nag you. But the way a child's mind works, they are functioning in the here and now. They cannot project forward because the mental energy they need to function in the here and now, it's all taken up. They cannot project backward. So it takes up all their energy to function in the here and now. When I was in Auschwitz, I thought that the whole world was a big concentration camp, that everybody in the world lived like I lived, in miserable condition, surrounded by Nazi guard day and night, starving to death, until the end of August. One late afternoon, an airplane appeared over the skies of Auschwitz. It was flying very low. I could see the American flag on one of the wings. And how on earth did I know anything about the American flag? This little village where I was born in, we didn't have electricity, no running water, no paved road, and not much information about the world. I knew that there was a Romania and Romanian flag. I knew there was a Hungary, they occupied us, the Hungarian flag. I knew there was Germany and the Hitler and the German flag. And we had an in Cleveland, Ohio, who would write us letters, and the stamp on the envelope was a flag. And that is the reason I knew how the American flag looked. But for me, in Auschwitz, to see an airplane with the American flag, what did it mean? It meant that somebody was trying to defeat the Nazis and free us. The more air raids we had, and the air raids continued and increased, we would applaud. I don't know, I was never afraid that they would bomb me. Because I saw the more air raids, the faster the Nazis would be defeated and we would be free. By November of 1944, we had 3 air raids a day. All the experiments stopped. And we, the children, developed the slogan, someday soon we will be free and we will go home. But we didn't know how that would happen. Nobody ever told us anything. The air raids continued until late January of 1945. I didn't know what date it was. One day we woke up, it was quiet. The sound of war were gone. Miriam and I talked about it. Could it be that today we are going to be free? We didn't know. We went outside. Outside, at a distance, we could see lots of people, and they were wrapped in white camouflage raincoats. They were smiling from ear to ear. I had no idea who these people were, but one thing was sure, they didn't look like the Nazis. We ran up to them, they gave us chocolate, cookies, and hugs. And that was my first taste of freedom. For me to realize that Miriam and I were alive, that we have triumphed over unbelievable evil, that my little promise to myself, that first night in the latrine became a reality. That was an unbelievable experience. I want to thank you for listening to my lecture. Today's lecture is number 39 this year. Last year I gave 180. So all I'm trying to tell you is that I talk a lot. Why do I talk so much? Not because I like to hear the sound of my own voice, but because I am very interested in sharing you my life lessons, lessons that I have learned in my life. As I look at you, there are some young people here. Life lesson number one, never give up on yourself or on your dreams. For you young people, I know, I remember, growing up is very hard. Very hard, even if you live in the United States, even if you have loving parents. And if God asked me for one wish, I would wish that every child on the face of this earth was born to loving parents. And even if your loving parents are wealthy enough and will buy you designer jeans with holes in them, even then, every single one of you wonders, how on earth will I fit into this big, big world? Will I be able to accomplish in life what I set out to do? And I can tell you one thing, if you give up, nothing will happen. On the other hand, if you keep hammering away at it, your wonderful mind will come up with answers that will work. I had no idea how to survive Auschwitz. There were no survival courses taught in Auschwitz. I tried different ideas. And here I am, 73 years after liberation, very happy to be alive. The last few years, I became fascinated with one thing that I want to share with you. I know that young people like to be stylish and designer clothes and designer that, and I don't really think that they are working. I tried many things when I was young. I thought that if I would dye my hair jet black, I would look like Elizabeth Taylor. I want you to know that I never look like Elizabeth Taylor. So I guess people try different things, but the most important thing that you have is this wonderful thing called the human mind. And I would like you, and you would like to be happy in your life. I have a little formula. 3 steps. 1. Study, read everything you can to develop your mind. There is no substitute for it. 2. I know from personal experience that young people are very mean to one another. I don't know why that is, but you are mean to one another. In every school in the United States, there are children who sit alone at the lunch counter by themselves. From today on, I hope if that happens in your school, that you are a popular kid, you organize your friends and make a friendship club, a lunch club, whatever you want to call it. Do not let any of your classmates ever sit by themselves at lunchtime. Be kind, not because somebody will give you a reward, but because it's the right thing to do. And you know what is the right thing to do. Third, I sold real estate for 34 years. So I went to many homes, and the rooms of the teenagers always looked like the tornado hit it. I personally do not like sloppy things, dirty things. Unfortunately, emotionally, it throws me back to the dirty barrack. But I don't think that it's good for you either. I want you young people who leave your beds messy and your room's messy, get up 20 minutes earlier, fix your bed, straighten out your clothes. Even I want you to pick up trash outside your home and everywhere you can. Let me show you a gadget in case you don't want to pick it up by hand. I have a grabber. So let's here. I carry it with me because if I drop something, I cannot pick it up. This way, you don't want to pick up the trash. With the wind, you can keep it up to the grabber. You are not only cleaning up your neighborhood, you are making the world a better place. And the world seems to need it desperately. There are dirty people, throw so much trash around. Why? One of the things, for instance, when I go to any bathroom, the trash cans are mushrooming with paper towels. Don't ever drop it on the floor. Put your foot into the trash can and press it down. I do that every time at the museum. And please, flush the toilet. Think of somebody else who's going to use it. These are simple things that you can do. And when you do these 3 things, you are going to be very happy. You are going to like who you are. And that is a purpose. Because as you grow up, you don't really know who you are, and you are trying to find your way. And when you are kind, people will like you, but you are changing the lives of other people. Did any of that cost any money? No. Did any of my lessons took a lot of time? No. And it's making a difference in the world. Life lesson number two deals with prejudice. What is prejudice? Prejudice means to prejudge people without really knowing them. Prejudice hurts the victims, it hurts everybody, and it destroys societies that permit it to happen. So again, going back to our wonderful minds, we can make a decision that we will treat each other with respect and fairness. And we are again making a difference in the world. I will tell you one thing. I am very, very annoyed with people in society today protesting that they don't have equal rights. I think that's baloney. The other day, just women were protesting for women's rights. One of the girls, ladies called me, said, I'm going to the protest. I said, I'm not going to protest. I have more rights than I can use. I can be anything I want to be and do whatever I want to do within the law. Now, if you want to go and take care of a mother who has two children who needs help, that is something I cannot understand. But protesting, you have got all the rights that you can have. And being a victim, it's you choose. There are laws to protect us from every kind of discrimination. And protesting has never helped anybody in the recent years. And I know that it's a very popular thing. We are talking about the terrible shooting in Florida, and I know it's a terrible thing. Protesting will help it. Maybe if we taught each other to forgive, not right away, I think that's a little bit too soon, or if we did something to help the families, but the protest, it doesn't really help. I know it's a reaction to that. We want to express ourselves in some way. I would say if we help one of the families in some way, or spend time with them, or talk to them, or even maybe help them financially, I can understand. But the protest doesn't really help. It's similar to people wanting to do something and they don't know what to do. The protest, in my opinion, it doesn't work. If it makes you feel better, as long as you are not bothering anybody else, that's okay. And by law, we have more laws to protect everybody in the United States. The other reason I don't like protests, because protesters act like victims. And as a victim, how would you want to point to yourself as a victim? People say to me, oh, you poor little thing. You survived Auschwitz, you poor victim. I said, don't poor victim me. I am not a victim and I don't want to be identified as a victim. I am a very strong survivor. And being a victim makes me feel very weak and helpless. And would I want somebody to call me a victim and be poor and helpless? Who else wants to be helpless? If I ever ask you here, how many of you would volunteer to be victims? Raise your hands. That is what they are saying. Oh, you are a poor victim. Nobody wants to be a victim. Nobody wants to be a victim. Am I talking too long? Really? Okay. What happened? Life lesson number 3. Forgiveness. This is the most important thing that you can do. If anything wrong ever happened to you, you cannot change it. You cannot ignore it. You cannot edit it out. And no matter what you do, it happened. Now, people hold on to their pain as victims. That doesn't make it go away. I stumbled on the simple idea of forgiveness in 1993 after I met with a Nazi doctor, and he was willing to document the gas chamber in Auschwitz for me. Then I asked him about the gas chamber, and I wanted to some way thank him for his willingness to document the gas chamber. And after 10 months of brainstorming, going back to our wonderful mind, I came up with the idea, maybe a letter of forgiveness from me to him. I knew immediately that he would like it, but what I discovered for myself was life-changing. I discovered that I have the power to forgive. No one can give it to me, no one can take it away, and I can use it in any way I wish. And I want you to know that every single one of you here has that power. Every single one of you has the power to forgive. No one can give it to you, no one can take it away. You can use it in any way you wish. And so that is the way I arrived in Auschwitz in 1995 with my children, my son and my daughter. Dr. Munch came with his son, his daughter and granddaughter. He read, he signed his documentation of the gas chamber. I read my statement called Declaration of Amnesty. I signed it, and I immediately felt that all the pain I carried around for 50 years was lifted from my shoulder. I was no longer a victim of Auschwitz, nor was I a prisoner of my tragic past. I tweet a lot. I don't know if you do, and I will share with you 2 tweets about forgiveness. Forgiveness is the best revenge. From the moment you forgive, the perpetrator no longer has any influence or power over your life. Forgiveness is an act of self-healing, self-liberation, and self-empowerment. It's free. Everybody can afford it. It works. It has no side effects. But if you don't like the way you feel as a free person, you can go and take your pain back. No one will stop you. I call anger a seed for war. I call forgiveness a seed for peace. Congratulations. You survived my lecture. So I would be glad to answer 3 questions. 1, 2, okay, go ahead. Speak up, please speak up, I am 84, so I would like to hear you. Well, you didn't listen to me. 6 days a week, 3 days we were naked in a room being measured. I have no idea. I don't know how many twins were there. There are twins that died more left than more right. They never died in the barracks. They usually died in the lab. I don't know what the scope of the experiments were. We were never given any information. So I don't really know. I know only what was done to me. I tried to learn about the other twins. Then I met with them in 1985. I learned that some of the older twins in reproductive age were used in cross blood transfusion between male twins and female twins. Some male twins were castrated, and that Mengele wanted to figure out how to create males or females. He wanted to have complete control of human reproduction. Okay, look, that's what you wanted to hear? Okay, what's your question? What? Well, that's a very innocent question. I will ask you a question. Let's take a make-believe story that you are in a car accident, which could happen, right? And everybody dies, only you survive. You're on a road somewhere, you don't even know where you are. And you're 10 years old, my age. What are you going to do? Are you going to sit there and cry? We're talking about being a victim, right? What is even at age 10, or age 8, or age 6, because I have for you a story that a six-year-old, the whole family died in an airplane crash. She verified that everybody was dead. She was bleeding, but she was alive. It was dark. She took a twig, a stick, lit it from the fire on the airplane, and started walking out of there. So what I'm trying to tell you is that the instinct to survive is unbelievable. But let's say that she was scared. Did she have time to feel that she was scared? Would you have time to feel that you are scared? You would like to find a way to get out of there, right? And when you are in the mode of survival, you do not have time to be scared. There is just no, your mind doesn't work being scared and surviving, or being a victim and surviving, do not work together. If you stay by the car that got crashed and waited for help, what would happen? You would die. So there was no time to feel that I was scared, okay? That's the answer. Yes?
At what point did you start to hear rumors that death was a possibility for your family? And did that feel like it was...
It was the next day.
Well, I mean, like at your home, because you were...
When we got home, there were all kind of rumors that so-and-so was returning, and they had at the Jewish center where my aunt lived, the big city, they would have once a month an update list of people who from the area survived. And we'd always check it out to see. I hope that somebody else would come back. When we finally left Romania for Israel, I knew that everybody was dead. Yeah. Thank you.